Hello friends, welcome to the next topic of discussion, right? Under module 2, so far we have discussed about fill area primitives. We have seen the definition of what is fill area, what do we mean by polygon, the two types of polygons, which are concave polygon and convex polygon. Then we saw about how to identify concave polygons. There were two identification algorithms used, and then last topic was splitting the concave polygons. The concave polygons can be split by using two methods, which is rotational method and vector method. So the next topic of the next topic in your syllabus is splitting a convex polygon, right? So the convex polygon can be split by dividing it into a set of triangles. So we have seen that using triangles, right, we can easily divide a convex polygon. So what we do here is the basic concept is to define any sequence of three consecutive vertices, right? So in a given convex polygon, just identify three consecutive vertices to define a new polygon, which is a triangle. Now delete that middle triangle vertex from the original vertex list. Again, apply the same procedure to the modified list in order to strip off another triangle. So for example, if I take any rectangle or a hexagon, right? So first I'll be identifying any three vertices there inside the polygon. Then I will form a triangle and I will strip off that particular triangle from the original vertex list. Again, from the modified list, I will identify one more triangle using again three pairs of vertices, and again I will strip off that, right? So continue this particular procedure until the original polygon is reduced to just three vertices, right? This is how we split a convex polygon into a set of triangles. The next topic is interior and exterior regions of polygon, right? So we know that any polygon will have interior and exterior regions. So what do we mean by interior region is, if you take this for a particular polygon, here I have one rectangle, right, shaped polygon, and there is one more polygon which is intersecting the below polygon. Right? So in this, it is very difficult to identify which is the interior region and which is the exterior region and which region belongs to which polygon. Right? So to identify that particular concept, right? So we have two types of rules in this topic, which are basically used to identify the interior and exterior regions of the polygon. So interior region means the region which belongs to inner part of the polygon, we call it as interior region. Right, the one which is outside of the polygon, we call it as the exterior region of the polygon. So the basic concept goes like this. All the area filling algorithms, that is, we are using filling algorithms here in order to fill our polygons, right? So all these and other graphics process, they need to identify the interior regions of the objects, which is interior region and which is exterior region, right? So to identify that, it is very, very important. Right, we have to identify which is interior region and which is exterior region. It is not always clear which regions of the XY plane would be interior and which regions would be exterior to the object. Right, as we saw in this example here, it is not clear for the algorithm, area filling algorithm, right, to find out which is the interior region and which is the exterior region. Right, if at all I have to color this polygon in two different colors. Right, look at this here, the below polygon I have colored in red color, right? So whereas this part of the polygon I want to color it in green color. So whenever I want to do this, it is not so clear, right? So which is the interior region and which is the exterior region. So why is this? Because this is because in the algorithms we can give the vertices of the fill area in any order, right? So I can give the vertices of the fill area in any order, which does not specify which region is interior and which is exterior. So in order to find out which is interior region of the polygon and which is exterior region of the polygon, there are two tests to find out if the region is interior or exterior, right? So the first test is called as odd even rule, which is also known as the odd parity rule. The second rule is non-zero winding number rule, right? So one by one, let us see what are these different types of rules in order to identify the interior and exterior regions of the polygon, right? So coming to the first rule, which is called as the odd-even rule. So in the odd-even rule, what we do is we draw a line from any position P to a distant point outside the coordinate extents of the object and count the number of edges crossing along the line, right? So that means in this particular rule, we just draw an imaginary line from any point P, from any position P to a distant point which is outside the object. That means if I take my polygon, right? So from this, in this polygon, right, I will draw an imaginary line from any point P to the outside edges of the polygon, right? So if I take this line from this particular point, I am drawing one line which is outside the polygon. That is what they are telling here. Any position P to a distant point outside the coordinate extents of the object. Outside the polygon, we have to draw and we have to count the number of edges crossing along the line. So if at all the number of edges crossed by the line is odd, if it crosses an odd number of edges, right, then the point P is said to be the interior point, right? So if the number of edges crossed by the line is even, then the point P is called as the exterior, then the point P is in the exterior region, right? So for example, if I take this particular line, right, so I have drawn an imaginary line from this point to the outside extent of the polygon object, right? And we can see that this line is crossing how many edges? AG is one edge and DE is one more edge. It is crossing two edges. Two edges are intersecting to this particular line, right? So it is called as the exterior region because two is an even number, right? The rule says that if the number of edges crossed by the line is even, then the point P is in the exterior region, right? So we'll take one more example to find interior region. If I take this particular line, from this point P, I have drawn an imaginary line outside my object, right? And the number of edges crossed by this imaginary line is only one edge, right? So since it is one is an odd number, right? I say this particular point P is in the interior region, right? The same way, look at this particular line. Here also, I have taken only one, I have taken an imaginary line from this point, right? And it is crossing how many edges? Only one edge. So it is interior. This region is interior. If I take the point P and draw an imaginary line here, it is crossing one edge. So it is interior. If you take this particular point, again, it is interior. This particular point, it is interior. But what about this point? In this point, I'm crossing one and two edge. The imaginary line is crossing two edges. So this is called as an exterior polygon, right? So it is crossing two edges, so it is called as the exterior region, right? So like this, we'll identify the interior and exterior regions of the polygon. So the condition for odd even rule is we need to make sure that the line drawn from the point P, it should not intersect a vertex or any end point. That means whenever you are drawing the line from any imaginary point P, it should not intersect a vertex. It should not coincide with the vertex or any other end point. So keeping this in the mind, we have to just keep on drawing our imaginary lines, right? And we can identify the interior and exterior regions of the polygon, right? So the next rule is non-zero winding number rule. In this non-zero winding number rule method, right, we need to know the direction of each edge of the polygon. Right, so whenever they are giving the polygon, they should also give the directions in which that particular polygon is drawn. Right, so we have to first, the required input for this particular method is the direction of each edge in the polygon. Right, that is whether the edge is going in clockwise direction or it is going in counterclockwise direction. Counterclockwise is nothing but anticlockwise direction. Right, so then what we do is we are finding a winding number. The winding number is the number of times the polygon edges wind around a particular point in the anticlockwise or counterclockwise direction. We are taking one variable here, which is called as the winding number, and it is the number of times the polygon edges wind around a particular point. That means how many times that particular edge is crossing a point in an anticlockwise direction, right? We'll see an example. Then you'll come to know as to what exactly is this winding number, right? So how to apply this how to apply this non-zero winding number rule, right? So to apply a non-zero winding number rule, first we keep the initial value of the winding number as zero. As you can see here in this example, I have kept my initial value of the winding number as zero. Initially it will be zero. Then we imagine drawing a line from point P to outside the polygon, which does not pass through any vertex. Same concept as the odd even parity rule is used here. We just draw an imaginary line from any point P to outside of the polygon, right? Making sure that it does not pass through any vertex, right? Say for example, I stand here and this is my imaginary line, which I'm drawing from this particular point P, and it is not crossing any of the vertex, right? So consider this line I have drawn. Now, what we do is we add one to the winding number every time we intersect a polygon edge that crosses the line from right to left, and we subtract one every time we intersect an edge that crosses from left to right. So what do we mean by this is, say for example, I will stand here, right? So I am crossing an edge here, which is moving from, if I stand here and I'm seeing in this particular direction, right? So I'm standing here, imagine a person is standing here and he is seeing from this particular direction, then the edge is moving from my right to left. This is my left hand and this is my right hand, and the edge is moving to from right to left, right? So if the edge is moving to right, from right to left, that is anti-clockwise direction, I have to add one to my winding number, right? So initial value of the winding number was zero. I am drawing an imaginary line from this particular point P to outside of the polygon, and I am standing from this side and I am looking in this direction, right? So my edge is moving from right to left. Since my edge is moving from right to left, I will add one to my winding number. So winding number value is now one, right? So then, and then we subtract one every time we intersect an edge that crosses from left to right. That means after making the winding number as one, we see if this particular line is crossing any other edge. Yes, it is crossing one more edge. What is that one more edge? The one more edge is D to E. And this edge is moving from in which direction? It is moving in clockwise direction from left to right, right? So since it is moving in clockwise direction, we have to subtract one. So our winding number value was plus one. So if I subtract minus one, it will become plus one and minus one, which will be equal to zero, right? So if the value is zero, right? So then it is considered as an exterior point, right? So the non-zero winding number rule tells that the interior points are those that have a non-zero value for the winding number. So non-zero value means it can be either a negative value or it can be a positive value, but it is not zero. It is not zero. It can be either negative or positive. Whereas the exterior points are those whose value of the winding number is zero, right? So in our example, we got initial value of the winding number as zero. Then since the direction is anti-clockwise direction, right? So it is the edge is moving from right to left. I will add one to my winding number. So winding number value became one. Again, this particular line is crossing one more edge from left to right. So I will subtract the value one. I will get plus one minus one as zero. And since I got a zero, this particular region, right, where my point P is situated, I consider it as an exterior region, right? So take this example, right? From this point A point, I am drawing one line, right? So it is crossing an edge which is from right to left, anti-clockwise direction. So initial value of the winding number will be zero, right? So later on, since it is from right to left, I will get it as plus one, right? So it is any non-zero value. Since it is non-zero value, I will call this as an interior region, right? So if I take this, if I'm taking an imaginary line from here to here, at that time what will happen, right? So since it is crossing only, if I take this line, since it is crossing only one edge, right? So if you take this only, right? If you take this particular line, right, from here and you are seeing in this direction, what is happening? Initial value of the winding number is zero. Then I am having a line which is moving from in a clockwise direction, right? So the value will be minus 1. Again, it will come, this line will come, and it is intersecting one more edge, which is also moving in clockwise direction. So minus 1, minus 1, I will get the value as minus 2, right? So since minus 2 is any non-zero value, I will consider this particular region as interior region, right? So out of these two types of rules to identify the interior and exterior region, the non-zero winding number rule is considered to be the best and effective, right? So the next topic is, hope you have understood the two types of rules in order to identify the interior and exterior regions, the odd even rule and the non-zero winding number rule, right? So moving on to the next topic, it is about the polygon tables, right? So we have seen a polygon. What is a polygon? A polygon is a closed figure, right? So because I cannot have an empty polygon, it should be, a polygon means all the vertices and edges, it should be closed. So this is a polygon. If I take V1 to V3, V3 to V4, V4 to V5, V5 to V1. If at all I don't connect this edge, then it doesn't become a polygon. Say for example, if E6 is deleted, right? Then I'll have only V1 to V3, V3 to V4, V4 to V5, right? If this is deleted, then it is not considered as polygon. A polygon is nothing but a closed figure, right? It is a closed figure, right? So in order to represent the vertex table and the edge table of the polygon, we make use of different polygon tables, right? So the first table what we are studying in this topic is vertex table. So if any vertex in a polygon is defined by three coordinates, as we know, it is x, y and z coordinate. So vertex V1, we call it as x1, y1 and z1. Vertex V2, which is here, is x2, y2 and z2. V3, x3, y3, z3. V4, x4, y4, z4. V5, x5, y5 and z5. These are the five vertices we have. So this forms the vertex table. Now coming to the edge table. What is an edge? An edge is nothing but a connection between the two vertices, right? So if I take edge E1, it is connecting between V1 and V2. So I write in my edge table E1 as V1 comma V2. Then E2 is a connection between V2 and V3. So V2 comma V3. Then E3 is a connection between V3 and V1, right? E4 is a connection between V3 and V4. E5 is a connection between V4 to V5. E6 is a connection between V5 to V1, right? So like this, we'll identify the different vertices which are basically used in order to form that edge, right? So, and the corresponding edge table is written like this, right? So then we have one more table, which is called as a surface facet table, right? What is a surface shape? A surface shape can be defined as a mesh of polygon patches. If I take this particular polygon, there are two patches of this polygon, right? So one patch of the polygon is V1 to V2 to V3 to V1. This is called as the surface 1, right? And one more patch or facet of the polygon is V1 to V3, V3 to V4, V4 to V5, V5 to V1, right? So these are the two facets or faces of the polygon, right? So geometric data for the objects can be arranged in three lists, right? So the three lists are nothing but vertex table, edge table and surface facet table, right? So if I take surface 1, the surface 1 is formed by connecting three edges, which is E1, E2 and E3. So I write surface 1 is formed by connecting three edges, E1, E2 and E3. Then I have the surface 2. Surface 2 is formed by connecting the edges, which is E3, E4, E5 and E6, right? So like this, we write different types of tables for a given polygon, right? So this is geometric data table representation for two adjacent polygon surface facets, which are formed with six edges and five vertices. As you can see, there are five vertices here and there are six edges here, and we are writing three types of tables, which are vertex table, edge table and surface facet table. So the next topic what we have is plane equations, right? So the general equation of a plane we know, right? So in this particular plane equation, right, so we know that the information about any orientation of any surface component is required, right? So how we are rotating or how we are orienting the polygon, right, is very important. So this information is obtained from the equations that describe the polygon surfaces. So each polygon is contained within a plane of infinite extent. So where I'm drawing any polygon, if I take any polygon is drawn in some plane, right? So that is why we consider the plane equation. So the general equation of a plane is given by ax plus by plus cz plus d is equal to 0, where x comma y comma z is any point on the plane. This is the standard plane equation. Right. So what we do here, we are having three points ax plus by plus cz. Right. So a is defined by x1, y1 and z1. B is defined by x2, y2, z2, and C is a point which is defined by x3, y3, and z3, and D is a constant. So we obtain A, B, C, and D values by solving a set of three plane equations, right? So we are obtaining A, B, C, and D values We are obtaining the set of three plane equations, right? So how we are obtaining this is by selecting three successive convex polygon vertices in anti-clockwise manner. That means we are having three vertices here, A, B, and C, right? So and what we do is we solve the set of simultaneous linear plane equations for A by D, B by D, and C by D. Right. So this you have already studied in your class 12, the Cramer's rule, in order to find out the determinants. So A by D xk plus B by D yk plus C by D zk, which will be equal to minus 1. So this equation, we are writing it by dividing it by D, right, where k is equal to 1, 2, 3. So the solution for this particular equation is obtained using Cramer's rule. Right, so we are finding out the determinants. So A is what? X1, Y1, Z1. So we write it as 1, 1, 1, 1, 1 here. For B values, we'll fill all ones here. And for C, we'll fill all ones here. And what is a D? D is the value which is obtained by D will be equal to, right, minus X, minus Y, and minus Z. Right, so minus D is equal to minus AX, minus BY, and minus CZ, right? So what is A? A is X1, Y1, Z1. So I'll write it as minus of X1, Y1, Z1. B is X2, Y2, Z2. So I'll write it as minus X2, Y2, Z2. C is minus X3, Y3, Z3. So minus X3, Y3, Z3, right? So we identify or we identify the four vertices values A, B, C, and D, right? Then by using the Cramer's rule and by using the determinant method, we found out the three. We find out the values of A, B, C, and D. So we know the determinant formula: plus, minus, plus, right? Then minus, plus, minus, plus, minus, plus, right? So keeping one constant, then taking the product y2 into z3, y3 and z2 minus y3 into z2, right? So like this, we will solve that particular equation, and finally we get A is equal to y1 of z2 minus z3 plus y2 into z3 minus z1 plus y3 into z1 minus z2, right? So for B, we are getting some value C and D. So this is how we solve the plane equation for the values of A, B, C, and D for a given polygon. So the last topic of today's session is front and back polygon faces, right? So what do you mean by front face of the polygon? The side of the polygon that faces into the object exterior, right? That means outward face, we call it as the front face, and the face which is to the interior of the polygon, we call it as the back face. As we know, in the cube, if I take a cube, right, the front face of the polygon is the one which is visible or it is outward, whereas the back face of the polygon is the one which is interior to that particular object, right? So every polygon is contained within an infinite plane that partitions the space into two regions, right? So two regions, in the sense, we'll have the interior region and we'll have the exterior region, right? So any point that is not on the plane and that is visible to the front face of the polygon surface section is said to be in the front of the plane, and that's why it is outside the object, right? So any point that is not on the plane and that is visible to the front face, right? So any point which is visible to the front face of the polygon, we say it is outside the object, and any point that is visible to the back face of the polygon, we say that it is behind the plane, right? So for example, if I take any polygon, right, so if it is the front face, then it will be visible, or it is outwards the side of the object. If it that particular point is in the back face of the polygon, then it is hidden, we cannot see it, right? So in order to identify which is the front face and which is the back face of the polygon, right, so we are determining by making use of the plane equation right? So by solving the plane equation, which is ax plus by plus cz plus d, if at all I get the value of this particular equation as less than 0, then I say the point x comma y comma z is behind the plane. And if at all ax plus by plus cz plus d, if I get it as greater than 0, then I say the point is in front of the plane, right? So then we are considering one vector here, which is called as the normal vector n for a plane. And it is described again by the plane equation ax plus by plus cz plus d equal to 0. And it has is perpendicular to the plane and has Cartesian components A, B and C. That means n is a vector here which is moving towards the positive x-axis, right? So the normal vector, it points in a direction from inside of the plane to outside of the plane, right? So I'm taking one vector which is coming from the back face of the polygon to the front face of the polygon. The normal vector for this plane is, since it is moving in the positive x direction, right? So I will write the normal vector as n is equal to 1, 0, 0, right? So this is x, y, and z. Since it is in the direction of positive x-axis, I will write it as 1 here, right? So the normal vector is pointing from inside the cube to the outside, and it is perpendicular to the plane, which is x is equal to 1, right? So in order to find out the value for this normal vector, with the elements of the normal vector can be obtained using the vector cross product calculation, right? So we will take two vectors and we will multiply those vectors and we will get the value for the normal vector, right? So, and finally we say that the plane equation can be expressed in the vector form by using the normal n and the position p of any point in the plane, right? So the plane equation, it can be written, the plane equation can be expressed in the vector form using the normal n and the position of p in the plane as n into p is equal to minus d. This is how we represent the normal vector and the position of p of any point in the plane. Thank you.